Friends, welcome to our Today's Knowledge Series video number 30. As you may observe that we have reached yet another milestone in our journey on Today's Knowledge Series. Yes, we have reached the 30th video of this particular series. And today we will be discussing Ind AS 106, which is for a specific type of industry. The industries which are in mining activities, industries who are in oil and gas, industries who are actually tapping the natural resources, for them, how they have to account for the exploration and evaluation assets as part of this particular standard is what we are going to discuss. One important point which I wanted to add as part of our discussion is that there is no equivalent accounting standards in India with respect to Ind AS 106, except there is a guidance note which has been issued by the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, which prescribes the accounting treatment for mining industries, oil and gas industries, and any industry which is tapping the natural resources. So accordingly, our discussion on Ind AS 106 assumes importance for this type of specific industries. Before we move into the standard proper, one of the requests which I always have is that many of you are sending questions to me to my email ID, or you are texting me. When I'm answering, the answer goes only to the particular person. So my request is, please post your questions, the clarification you are seeking for, or any other inputs which you wanted to give in our YouTube channel itself, so that when I answer, it becomes public for everyone who is the subscriber of our channel to see that the moment I upload the answers or my comments on the particular point which you have raised. With that, let me move on to understand what actually there in Ind AS 106. This standard is a simple standard, nothing to worry too much about this. It's a small standard as well. As such, what we normally do is to see the structure of our discussion. We will see what is the core principle which is covered by means of this particular standard. That is the first and foremost importance for us, because unless we understand what is the requirement of this particular standard, what is the principle which is governed by this standard, we may be directed to a different direction, and it may not be helpful for us. So that's the reason why every time I'm trying to bring out what is the core principle of this particular standard, when it has to be applied for. We will see what are scoped in this standard and what are scoped out of this standard for us to understand. And similarly, what is the recognition principles which are given in this particular standard is of prime importance for us to have a discussion. And what after the recognition, that is when the evaluation and exploration assets has to be accounted for, or they are ready for recognition. And what is the measurement, what is the value which we have to attribute towards those particular items is the next important aspect which we will discuss. When we are measuring, there are certain things which we are supposed to think about the cost of this particular exploration and evaluation activities for mineral resources. And to that extent, we should understand what can be included in the cost, what cannot be part of the cost. That is another discussion which we will have. And there are specific guidances which has been given when an entity involved in exploration and evaluation of mineral assets, when it can change its accounting policy. That is the next important aspect. Normally, Ind AS 8 governs the change in accounting policy of any entity. But for Ind AS 106, there are some specific guidances when it wants to change its accounting policy. Let us try to understand that aspect as well. And finally, how this exploration and evaluation assets has to be presented as part of our financial statement, which is prepared in Ind AS. And of course, whether any impairment has to be assessed with respect to any of this exploration and evaluation asset. As you may aware that the moment I talk about an asset, immediately it requires to be tested for impairment to ensure the carrying amount is no longer maintained above the its recoverable amount, right? So accordingly, this will also undergo an impairment test, which we will discuss. And finally, what is the important disclosures this standard is requiring an entity to make is the next piece of our discussion. With that, let's go into the core principle. What do you mean by the core principle of this particular standard? As I said, it gives an interim solution. It is not actually giving a full-fledged standard. So that means an entity which is already using certain principles as per the guidance note, and to that extent, there is no need for changing its accounting policies. It can continue to adopt the existing principle. That is what I have to tell you. So it can continue to use it other than specifically talked about in this particular standard. Let's see what is this interim standard says is how to account for the exploration and evaluation expenditure an entity has incurred. When you are talking about exploration and evaluation expenditure, if you understand what is the principles of an entity which is involved in tapping the natural resources or mineral resources, one interesting point you may observe is that it has exploration and evaluation stage and it goes for the development stage. The exploration and evaluation stage is like a research phase, as what we have seen in Ind AS 38 intangible asset. However, the difference in this particular standard is the exploration and evaluation expenditure will be capitalized and will not be charged. It will be aggregated or it will be accumulated. And once the development stage goes in, the development cost will also be added to that. And the total cost will be amortized based on the unit of production which the entity will be making out of the mineral resources. That is exactly what we are going to see. There are two phases, exploration and evaluation. That means when the entity is identifying whether the mineral resources are available or the oil reserves are available and whether it is commercially viable to tap that. Up to that stage is called exploration and evaluation. And after that, it develops or exploits that mineral resources for commercial sale. And that is what we call as a development expenditure. Both expenditure are accumulated and amortized over the expected unit of production based on the reserves. How you will identify the estimated reserves? You will do geophysical analysis. You will do what we call as scientific analysis of certain things which you will observe. We will discuss those aspects as also as part of this particular standard. So two stages, but we are talking about only the first stage. The moment the first stage is over, the standard says that it will go to the respective accounting standard. For example, if I have used certain property, plant and equipment for the purposes of exploration and evaluation stage, and it reached the development stage, it will go to Ind AS 16. If I have acquired certain rights to exploit the mineral reserves, that goes for an intangible asset. And any related cost, whether it is directly attributable to the property, plant, equipment or to the intangible assets, like that it will be capitalized. That is the principle which we are having up to this particular exploration and evaluation stage. It offers the guidance. That is Ind AS 106. And as I said, the moment you have reached the development phase, there is no further applicability of this standard. This standard stops at that level. And we will go to the respective standards for accounting for the expenditure incurred at the development phase, once the development phase started. So that is what we have seen. This is the core principle which you have to keep it in your mind. And accordingly, you should be able to understand what is the exploration expenditure, what is the development expenditure. based on that, your entire accounting principles will be governed by Ind AS 106. Are clear on this? Let's move on to our next slide. Okay. The core principle is also governed by one more slide for you to understand the concept of this standard more clearly for the actual application of this particular standard is that the financial reporting for exploration for and evaluation, we call it as an E&E asset or EEA asset for mineral resources. It is a limited improvement to the accounting principles. As I have said, it's a limited revision or limited improvements, or it has a limited guidance. It don't go beyond that. And it also gives a guidance for once the first part is accounting practices to be adopted for exploration and evaluation expenditure, and to check whether this exploration and evaluation assets, whatever you are retaining or accumulating as part of your cost, whether that will be eligible for carrying over or any impairment has to be tested. For example, I have dropped the idea of developing a particular oil well. What to do with that particular expenditure is also governed by that particular principle. And the third part of this standard is talking about what is the disclosures which are required, how you have accounted for the exploration and evaluation assets in respect of Ind AS 106. One is accounting for the E&E expenses. Second is to test for impairment. And third is to talk about what are the disclosures which are required to be given. So these disclosures will be able to understand. It will make the users to be able to understand the amount, timing, and certainty of the future cash flows arising out of the exploration and evaluation assets which are recognized by the entity. So the user should understand what is the amount of expenditure which will be further spent, what is the timing of the expenditure which will be spent, and what is the possible cash inflows which will be coming once it reaches the development phase. All those items are part of this particular disclosure requirement. Okay. Now, what is scoped in and what is scoped out? Scoped in is all items relating to the stage of exploration and evaluation expenditure. So that is very clear. What is scoped out? Suppose an entity has incurred certain expenditure, and those expenditure are before they have taken the legal right to explore a particular area. For example, if I am saying that the government of India has actually announced auctioning of particular coal fields, and to apply for that, I am making certain efforts and I have applied for the legal rights. The legal rights is not yet given to me, or allotment of the particular area of coal mill fields are not allotted to me. Whatever expenditure I have incurred up to that stage is scoped out of this. We have to see whether it will meet the requirement of an asset. If it is not meeting the requirement of an asset, it should be charged to P&L. Normally, it will be charged to the profit and loss account, because at that point of time, we do not have any control on economic benefit arising out of the possible, because it's only a possible intangible right. Up to that, there is no intangible right. So control is not there. It will be charged to the profit and loss account. So it will not be allowed to be part of E&E expenditure as per Ind AS 106. Secondly, after the technical feasibility and commercial viability of extracting a mineral resource has been demonstrated, that is nothing but a development phase. Up to that period, you are exploring and you are evaluating whether you will be able to tap the mineral resources. And whatever you do up to that period is not reaching a situation where it will be commercially available for exploitation. The moment you have reached that particular stage, it is called a development phase, and any expenditure incurred on reaching or after reaching the development phase is not part of this particular standard. As we have already discussed in the core principle, it will go to the respective standards. We will test whether those expenditures are eligible to be capitalized in accordance with those particular standards. If yes, then we will capitalize, or otherwise we will charge off to the P&L account. Very simple. Now we move on to some understanding by means of a question. Here we are saying A Limited incurred legal expenditure of 2 crores before acquiring land, before obtaining a legal right for the exploration. That's what I have said. Normally, whenever there is a mineral reserves, those lands are only given for exploitation over a period of time. Or otherwise, we will say that it's only a right to exploit and not the land itself is sold by the government. Unless you already owe that as a what we call as a freehold land. So 90%, or maybe I can even say that 90 to 95% of the cases, the mineral resources are the asset of the government of India, and the government of India actually auctions the particular right to exploit for a particular period. So you will develop, you will do an exploration, evaluation, and then develop it, and out of the development you take the mineral resources. When you take the mineral resources, normally there will be a what we call this a product sharing contract. That means whatever is the production which is happening, I can use the word production sharing contract. Whatever is the production or the development which you have done or the exploitation which you have done, those products are shared. Government has a share as part of the production sharing arrangement, plus the any other joint venturer who are part of that. Normally what happens is, in respect of oil and gas industry or a mining activity, the cost of exploration and evaluation and development will be much, much higher, and accordingly lot of participants will be joining together as part of their activity as a joint venturer, and one person will be the operator of the entire block. That's the way in which it normally happens, right? So in this particular case, what we are saying is that they have incurred certain legal expenditure before obtaining the legal right of the exploration, and even before the land has been allotted. Whether that expenditure is allowed to be capitalized as part of exploration and evaluation asset as per Ind AS 106. As we have said, it is an expenditure incurred before the exploration, before you have got the legal right for exploration, and to that extent the expenditure has to be expensed in the profit and loss account in the period in which it has been incurred. Second, we take another example. X Limited has completed the activity of exploration and drilling of coal mine. It has also reached the commercial viability of extracting the coal. Can the subsequent expenditure be accounted as per Ind AS 106, the moment I reach the commercial viability, it completes the stage of exploration and evaluation. That is what the industry is talking about. And that is what this standard is also, it gives a guidance. And the moment I reach the development stage, as we have said in the core principle, those expenditure cannot be accumulated as part of E&D expenditure. It has to be accumulated as a development expenditure and then to be amortized if it meets the recognition criteria of an asset with the respective standards. Otherwise, you have to charge it off. In this particular scenario, it cannot be accumulated as per Ind AS 106. We have to go to the respective standards to see whether it is possible for me to capitalize that expenditure or to charge to the profit and loss account. 106 does not have any application beyond this particular point. Now, let us understand the accounting principle, because you have to have a little bit of understanding of this industry, then you will know that. There are two methods which are provided in the guidance note as well, and globally two methods of accounting which is being adopted for the purposes of financial reporting by an entity which is involved in this type of specific industry. One, it is called successful efforts method. In second is called full cost method. The name itself will suggest you what they mean by this. When I say successful effort method, what I do is the cost of finding, acquiring and developing the reserves are capitalized field by field basis depending upon the nature of operation. For example, if a vast area has been allocated, normally the exploitation will start by field by field. So for example, see in Godavari basin, one particular area has been allocated under a production sharing arrangement by the Ministry of Hydrocarbon. What I will try to do is that first I will try to see out of the entire area, say for example it's some kilometers of radius has been allocated to me, I will start to do my geophysical activity and also I will try to understand whether the reserves are available in which area, and based on that I will make them into different production field. In the same area I will have 2-3 field or maybe more than that also depending upon the area, and for each field I will allocate what is the cost. Maybe for you to make the understanding, it is like a smallest group of individual assets which can generate cash flows independent of other assets. What we have seen this? Yes, cash generating unit. Similar to a cash generating unit, a field when it is exploited will be able to generate cash flows independent of the other areas of field. So that by field, the cost will be accumulated, and once the development stage comes in, it will be amortized. Suppose if something goes wrong, what will happen? For example, if I'm saying in that particular field, when I have done the exploration and evaluation expenditure, a lot of expenditure has been incurred, but after 2 years, I have identified that it is not successful to exploit commercially. And I close that particular field and I have closed that particular activity. In that particular stage, whatever evaluation and exploration which I have added should be tested for impairment. Like what we have seen, CGU basis, here field by field basis, we will test the impairment. And once the commercial exploitation happens, what is the total cost which I have incurred for the particular field will be amortized over the expected unit of production of that particular field. That is what successful efforts method. Once it is successful, I will start amortizing the expenditure. If it is not successful, the entire thing will be charged off the P&L account field by field basis. To understand that, I am drawing the reference like a cash generating unit, right? Smallest group instead of the entire group. On the other hand, the full cost method, now you might have understood what is full cost method, is nothing but you will accumulate all the cost for the entire geographical cost center. For example, Godavari basin, some 4 kilometers radius of activity has been allocated to me. I will accumulate all the cost of exploration, evaluation and development of the entire area, and those costs will be capitalized. The moment I start a commercial operation, I will amortize this expenditure on a pro rata basis on the expected production which will come out of this. So in the full cost method, what we will do in case if a particular field is considered to be not viable, that will also be charged as a capital expenditure. Okay, so that is the full cost method, because for that particular field or particular geographical area, entire cost, full cost incurred in development is part of my cost. That includes even the cost of abandoning a particular well or a mining activity. Whatever cost incurred up to that stage is also added to that. That's a full cost method. As I have said, in successful effort method, the moment you have discovered commercially viable or proven mineral resources, the capitalized cost can be allocated to the particular discovery and it will be amortized. Whereas here, even the cost include cost of unsuccessful wells as well. That's what I have said. Abandoned wells will also be added to the cost and it will not be charged to P&L. In the event of such discovery is not achieved, the expenditure is charged to P&L because we are talking about successful efforts. If it is unsuccessful, that will go to the P&L. This is what the successful efforts method. As opposed to, this will be amortized only on the entire reserves of the full pool. So I will identify what is the expected reserves of the entire area and whatever cost I have capitalizing for the entire area will be amortized over the period. This is what is presently being adopted for all the entities which are exploiting the mineral reserves, exploiting the natural reserves, exploiting the oil and gas reserves, coal mines, gold mines, whatever you are talking about is covered by this particular principle. You might have also seen one of the entity, very large entity in India, which is following full cost method before, has moved to successful efforts method as per Ind AS 106. And in that process, whatever cost of unsuccessful wells, which it is carrying as part of full cost method, they said that because of the change in accounting policy as per Ind AS, the entire unsuccessful cost which has been included as part of my full cost method is charged to the opening retained earnings on transition to the successful effort method. So now if you ask me whether the successful efforts method and full cost method is still permitted, it is based on a simple principle as I have already said. What is the accounting policy which you are following already? It is permitted to be followed by the entity. If the entity wants to change the accounting policy, paragraph 10 of Ind AS 8 should be applied. Paragraph 10 of Ind AS 8 says, when the entity believes that a change in accounting policy will result in more relevant and reliable information, then you can apply that particular accounting principle. That's what that particular entity has done. It has felt that instead of full cost method, if I apply a successful effort method, that will give a more relevant and reliable information for my users. On that basis, I have applied Ind AS 106 on a retrospective basis. And 101 says whenever you are applying that on a retrospective basis, the expenditure up to the date of transition, whatever is not going to be recognized as an asset, will be debited to the retained earnings. That's the way in which the entity has actually accounted for that particular aspect. It has, to my mind, it has charged around 50,000 crore of expenditure, which was carried as part of capital expenditure in respect of its mining activity, oil and gas industry, and it has actually charged to P&L retained earnings on the opening adjustment to transition to Ind AS. So even now, an entity can continue to adopt the Ind AS 106 in the existing accounting principle. Only if you wanted to change the accounting principle, what you are supposed to see is whether it is making a relevant and reliable interpretation or making a relevant and reliable presentation for the users. In that case, you can change the accounting policy. That is what Ind AS 106 talks about as far as accounting policy change is concerned. What is the recognition principle? It says that this standard, that's what I am saying, paragraph 10 of Ind AS 8, will be applied in developing an accounting policy for recognizing exploration and evaluation asset. So if I already use a successful effort method, that is my accounting policy. If I believe that method is not giving relevant and reliable information, but a full cost method will give me better and reliable information, I will move on to full cost method, which is permitted as per para 10 of Ind AS 8. On the other hand, if you believe that I am following a full cost method of accumulating all the cost, including the cost which is relating to an abandoned well. This abandoned well is not going to generate a cash flow, but I have accumulated that on the assumption that I am using a full cost method for the entire geographical area which has been allotted to me. In that situation, is it correct to carry certain assets which are literally impaired? So that's what that particular entity or particular company has applied, and they have concluded that it is not correct on my part to use this. It's a more relevant and reliable accounting principle will be to use a successful effort method, and accordingly, using paragraph 10 of Ind AS 8, that entity has moved on. So for developing an accounting policy, you can use paragraph 10 of Ind AS 8, relevant and reliable information if the users will get to that extent, you will be applying a new accounting policy. You are permitted to change the accounting policy. But at the same time, there are another two paragraphs in Ind AS 8, paragraph 11 and 12, which is saying, suppose if you do not have any other accounting principles specific to this particular industrial activity. For example, as we have said, we don't have an accounting standard for the purposes of exploration, evaluation, and development of mineral resources. And paragraph 10 also talking only that particular stage. If suppose there is an accounting standard, you will apply that accounting standard. If there is no accounting standard, entity is allowed to develop an accounting principle. In that case, paragraph 10 is talking about relevant and reliable information will be provided to the users. If I'm selecting a new accounting principle, I develop a new accounting policy. Okay, that is permitted. So the new accounting policy has been developed as per the permission given, and I'm going to see whether full cost method is beneficial or the successful effort method is beneficial. That is one thing which I can do as per para 10. What para 11 says is that in case you do not have an accounting policy in respect of that particular business or the activity, in this case, it's a exploration and evaluation of mineral resources. If you don't have a specific accounting standard, you can look for identical Ind AS which allows you to give an accounting principle for that. That is paragraph 11. Paragraph 12 says, if even an identical guidance is not available, you can go to IFRS, you can go to any other standard setting body in the world which can be accepted as a generally accepted accounting principle, or any other industry practice, you can use any of them. That is paragraph 12. 10 is talking about if there is no standard available, entity can develop an accounting principle based on whether it will result in a relevant and reliable presentation. That it will shall apply. That means it has to apply. Second is that paragraph 11 and 12 is exempted, means it's an option. You can apply the option. If no guidance is available here, you can go to international standards. It's also available as an option, but that is an option because it's only an exemption and it's not mandatory application. Why that particular company has applied the successful efforts method? Because of the word shall apply paragraph 10, but that is mandatory. Why it has not gone for US GAAP or IFRS? Because IFRS also has a limited guidance. US GAAP has a very detailed guidance. Why it has not gone for US GAAP at that point, in that particular point? It is an exemption. For its application of paragraph 10 gives the relevant information, why should I go for developing a new accounting principle, right? This is what is the recognition principles of Ind AS 106. Now, how to measure the exploration and evaluation asset? It should be measured at cost because it's an asset. It's not a financial asset. Only for financial asset, there is a mandatory requirement that we have to account it on the basis of what we call as part of our fair value measurement. Whereas in all other cases, we will account that as a cost. For example, property, plant, equipment, intangible assets, investment property, etc. So that is the same principle we will apply for exploration and evaluation assets. Subsequently, how we will do is, either cost model will be available or revaluation model is available. Like property, plant, equipment and intangible asset, you can use the cost model. That means cost model means accumulated cost less accumulated amortization less accumulated impairment asset. But amortization will not start for a simple reason. Exploration and evaluation is not reaching the development phase. You do not know what is the probable reserves which you will have, how many units you will exploit. So you don't have the amortization at that point, but accumulated impairment could be possible, right? In that case, it's a cost model. Revaluation model is you are going for fair valuing at the reporting date and seeing what is the market value of the related asset. On that basis, you will either impair certain assets or you will increase the value of the asset. When I use the revaluation model, automatically the principles of taking it to OCI is applicable and not taking to credit to P&L account is possible. It should be routed through OCI, the revaluation surplus, right? With the debit to the asset concern. This is subsequent measurement. The entity may apply the revaluation model. The moment I am saying revaluation model, it goes for Ind AS 16 in respect of property, plant, and equipment, whatever assets which are incurred. For example, in exploration, I may be having a rigs. I may be having certain machinery. I may be using certain assets for reaching that particular field. For example, if it's an ocean-based exploration, I have to travel. So helicopters and other things may be hired or they may be owned by the entity. So in that case, those model of the assets has to be considered. If you are applying revaluation model, you will apply Ind AS 16 property, plant, equipment. In case if it is an intangible right, a production sharing contract which I have entered into with the government of India, in that case, what is the right which you are having is an intangible asset. For revaluing the intangible asset, you have to go to Ind AS 38 intangible asset standard. So the relevant standard, because this standard gives a minimal guidance. It only says that go back to the respective standards and apply it. The moment I have classified a particular item on cost model, or I have classified a particular item on revaluation model, I'm expected to consistently adopt that model. Even though it uses the word shall be, I can actually use the similar principles given in Ind AS 16 and Ind AS 38. From revaluation model, I can come to the cost model at any point of time. There are certain guidances which is given how you have to recalculate your carrying amount. As if this revaluation has been never done, what is the depreciable amount? All those items has to be identified and then you will come down, right? The same principle will apply here also. But normally, 1 year I will do cost model, another year I will do revaluation model, again third year I will come back to cost model. That inconsistency should be avoided. It's a natural principle and it's a general principle for any accounting guidance. So there is nothing different in Ind AS 106. What are all the elements of cost which can be added as exploration and evaluation asset as per Ind AS 106? As I have said, we will decide what is the accounting policy as per Ind AS 8, and that policy will be applied consistently for making the capitalization of those associated cost in finding the specific mineral reserves. The examples of cost which you can understand, technical terms for the oil and gas industry, but you can understand that is acquisition of the right to explore, production sharing contract. I am getting the contract from the government to exploit the mineral resources for the particular field. It's a cost which I pay. Exploratory drilling. So I am drilling the land to identify how I can commercially exploit that. It may be drilling the earth if it is relating to land-based reserves, or it may be ocean-based or river-based. In that cases, it may be drilling in the particular river bed or the ocean bed. And related trenching activity, you have to clear it and you have to do that. And you will take a sample and test the samples. And you will use a topographical, geological and geochemical and geophysical studies. All these things are related to finding out what is the area in which the reserves are identified, which area the reserves are higher, how to tap the particular area. For example, when I do a drilling, say for example, the northwest corner of the entire field, the reserves are available. If I am doing an exploratory drilling at the northeast corner of this, I am actually doing something wrong, right? So the guidance, how it will be happening? By means of doing a geological study or geochemical studies and geophysical studies, we will identify the exact location of the resource and exact, map of the reserves, and which is the best area to tap the reserves, and then exploit that commercially in a viable situation. So for that, the topographical, geological, geochemical and geophysical studies will be carried out. Huge cost will be incurred. They will be using satellites, they will be using other state-of-the-art equipment, consultants will be, geologists will be involved. Very huge cost. So that cost will be part of the exploration and evaluation activity of an industry following Ind AS 106. And technical feasibility and commercial viability of extracting the mineral. Sometimes what happens is, why it is considered as an unsuccessful well? I have drilled it and I have found out that I have tapped the reserves. But only problem is, when I am exploiting the reserves, what is the output which I can draw from that well will be much, the value of that output will be much lower than the cost of exploiting that, taking it out. So in that case, the marketability will not be feasible, right? So because of that, I will write off that particular well and I close that well, abandoned well. Sometimes what happens is, they also use the word dry hole. What do you mean by dry hole? I thought that based on my geological and geochemical and geophysical studies, this is the best way of tapping the mineral resource. I have tapped it. But unfortunately, when the drilling has been happened, it was not able to go into the flow of the particular sequence. It's like you tap the water resources and going for drilling a well. And sometimes when you do the drilling, you will not be able to tap the water bed because the water flow is not proper in that area, and you have to abandon the well, right? That abandoning cost, whatever drilling cost which we have incurred up to that, including the cost of the machinery involved, their depreciation, all those items are considered as part of the dry hole, and we will charge it off in case if you are using successful efforts method as part of the accounting. Whereas on doing that particular activity, whether it is commercially viable or technically feasible, I have to do certain activity, I have to do certain expenditure to be incurred. Those expenditure will also be part of evaluation and exploration cost according to Ind AS 106. The moment I have decided that yes, it's technically feasible and commercially viable of extracting the mineral resources, this standard stops at that level. After that, we will go to the respective standard, because it has reached a development phase and it goes to accumulating the cost for development till such time actual commercial exploitation has started, and we will apply the respective accounting standards, intangible asset standard or Ind AS 16 property, plant, equipment, or any other standard to see whether this expenditure has to be charged off. Provisions we will make in respect of site restoration, etc. All those things we will apply the respective standard. That is exactly what we are talking about as the cost which are to be considered for recognition as per exploration and evaluation. What is the cost which we have said it's not covered? We said that the cost which is not covered is before obtaining the legal right. Another possible cost is that, as I have started making a passing comment, sometimes because you are disturbing the economic environment, where I do a drilling in the earth or riverbed or ocean bed, I have actually started disturbing the environment. If I am retaining that on an open basis as an open well, there could be an issue relating to economic related issue or pollution control related issues, or there could be a possibility of somebody is falling into that well and it causes a problem of human life is being disturbed. So to that extent, what I normally used to do is, I will try to find out, because every production sharing contract comes with a requirement that the site should be restored to its original condition after the end of the contract. Contract is given for 10 years to tap the mineral resources, exploit it, share a portion to the government, and sell the balance or share it with other joint venture operators. So the site restoration cost, or maybe I can say even they use the word called asset retirement obligation. Those removal and restoration of the drilling well, drilling bit, rigs. After that, there is a hole, right? That hole should be fully closed and should not be affecting the environment. This is one of the important condition on any production sharing arrangement. That cost of site restoration or removal is very huge cost. Even one of the company for which I have done an audit, the cost of the site restoration or plucking the dry holes or dry wells was more than $240 million, $240 million, not INR. So, but whereas that in a particular oil and gas industry was having only two fields, within the two fields, they have so much of provision required for site restoration cost. If those sites of restoration cost is charged to P&L account in the year in which it is incurred, that is not the correct representation, right? This cost is also relating to bringing the asset to the present location and condition for the intended use according to Ind AS 16 or according to Ind AS 38. And to that extent, this asset retirement or site restoration cost should also be capitalized as part of the asset, and those items will be amortized over the unit of measure development which I am expecting. At the same time, any expenditure related to the development phase should not be considered as part of exploration and evaluation. We have seen that in the general principle print slide itself. Now, let us take some example. L Limited has incurred 1.5 crore to increase the grade of coal which they have extracted from the mine. So they wanted to increase the quality of the grade so that the higher selling price will be available. Can this expenditure will be treated as exploration and evaluation expenditure as per Ind AS 106? Just to see whether it is part of your exploration and evaluation asset or it is after you have reached your development phase. You are very clear that it has already reached the development phase, and to that extent, this cannot be part of your E&E expenditure. It is a production cost of the coal because it's a reprocessing and increasing the quality or the grade of the coal. And to that extent, it is not part of your expenditure, exploration and evaluation. It has to be treated as part of your production. Now, what is the guidance given for change in accounting policy? As I have already told, you can apply para 10 of Ind AS 8, which says that the financial statements will be more relevant and more reliable to the economic decision making needs of the users. Because of that, I am changing the accounting policy. You have to mandatorily change, shall apply. That is what required as per Ind AS para 10 of Ind AS 8. And you have to demonstrate whatever accounting policy which you are following is closer to the meeting criteria as per Ind AS 8. Ind AS 8 says no, relevant and reliable. You have to actually demonstrate. You cannot simply say that I have changed it. How it has come closer to Ind AS 8 should be part of your disclosure requirement, as well as you have to demonstrate the principles as well. How it should be presented? The exploration and evaluation assets will consist of mainly two items. One is the tangible asset, the rigs, etc., which I am using, machinery which I am using. Those items will be tangibles, right? And there could be a lot of spares which I will be using, machine spares and the drill bits, etc., that will also be used. Those are tangible assets, or they are not considered as inventory. They are considered as a machine spares, and accordingly goes to Ind AS 16. And intangible, where the right to use or right to exploit is an intangible asset because it does not have a physical substance. What I will use is this classification has to be applied consistently, and every time you cannot mix it up, tangible between intangible. And for example, drilling rights is an intangible asset, whereas the vehicles, the drilling rigs and other machineries are tangible asset. You have to classify, and to that extent, these tangible assets are used in developing an intangible asset shall be part of the intangible asset. For example, certain items are required for the purposes of getting that intangible asset. It's a direct cost for that, that I will capitalize. The remaining will be capitalized as part of the tangible asset. Normally, very rare circumstances, right? It is a tangible asset will be part of the intangible asset, will be very rare circumstances. So this classification of tangible and intangible is what is required to be presented. Within the exploration and evaluation asset, you have to split between tangible and intangible. Impairment testing should be done where, instead of using the word indicators of impairment, it says you have to test when facts and circumstances suggest. What is the facts and circumstances suggest? The recoverable amount arising out of the particular field or successful effort will be much or it's lower than what I consider as part of my carrying amount. So the recoverable amount is lower than the carrying amount. Naturally, there is a requirement for us to apply the intangible asset standard. For that purpose, we will go to Ind AS 36 intangible assets. So you will apply the same principle what we have discussed earlier. That's what it says. You have to go by Ind AS 36 impairment of asset. Okay. Now, what could be the circumstances which can show that there could be an impairment indicator? Instead of using the word impairment indicators, as we have said, facts and circumstances indicate that there is an impairment assessment to be made. One, the right to explore the specific area has expired or will expire in the near future, and it is not expected to be renewed. That means you are losing whatever benefit which you are having or whatever expenditure you have incurred. You will not be able to generate any value in use subsequently, and you cannot sell it because your right itself is going to be there. So there is no fair value less cost of disposal. So in that case, there is an indication that you have to test it for impairment. Unless within the near future, you will exploit the entire reserves, that will take care of that. It's an circumstances which indicates that there could be an impairment. I have taken certain reserves as a production sharing contract I have entered into with the government of India. And I have also incurred certain exploration and evaluation expenditure. But I am not subsequently proceeding with the evaluation of that particular field, or either it is not being done, or I am not even making any plan or budget for subsequent expenditure. That itself shows that maybe I have considered viably, it is not viable to pursue that particular field. And to that extent, that shows that the facts and circumstances, there is an impairment of the particular E&E assets. In a specific area has not led to discovery of commercially viable quantities, and the entity has decided to discontinue that operation. That's what I have said. It has decided to abandon a well. It has decided to close out a dry hole because it is not successful to commercially exploit. Even though they have tapped the reserves, they believe that the cost of production will be much higher than the selling price. And accordingly, they have decided to discontinue the particular activity. That is also an indication that there is an impairment. And it also says that even if the development phase has been proceeded, but you are unlikely to recover the full portion by means of sale. So that it's also either by development or by sale of the right, indicating that the recoverable amount is almost zero or lower than your carrying amount. These are all the circumstances which could indicate that there is an impairment assessment required as per Ind AS 106. The moment you have identified there is an impairment assessment to be done, you will go to Ind AS 36, because this standard is having only a limited application towards how you will accumulate the cost and account for exploration and evaluation asset. All other principles are governed by the respective standard. As I have said, cash generating unit concept is like the entire geographical cost center or individual field. Normally, individual fields will be done, but sometimes the interconnectivity, that's the independent cash flows, could not be generated. Country by country basis also cost centers can be developed. But now if you see that relevant and reliable presentation, the country by country is not acceptable. Large geographical cost, full cost method is also not seems to be a relevant and reliable presentation. So individual fields will be the much better way of doing it. In that case, if you have incurred certain cost, which are common cost for all the fields, you have to allocate the cost to the respective CGU, a respective field to test it. Here the CGU is the smallest possible group of the individual fields which will generate cash flows independent of the other fields. That is what CGU. That is the reason why in the core principle itself I have brought in the concept of CGU to draw parallel to our understanding of Ind AS 36. So what is the specified level of testing the impairment? It will be based on the accounting principle. Each CGU or group of CGU, whatever you wanted to do, but it shall not be larger than a segment. Okay. So based on the segment analysis also, you can decide what is the way in which you can aggregate the CGU. That is, some flexibility has been given in this particular standard. So because of that, the area which you have identified, the level which you have identified, could be one or more CGUs or one or more fields, one or more segments. That is also possible, but preferably going for the smallest CGU is the best way of doing it. That's what we have understood, right? So let us see what is the impact of the impairment assessment which we are doing, or what is the way in which you can aggregate that in the next few slides, right? Okay, let's move on as we wanted to discuss about the next impact. I'm just taking one simple example. It's a very big a case study. You can understand the case study when you are seeing the video again and again. Here, what I am trying to say is that one entity which is involved in offshore oil and gas, that entity has a producing field A and B, which is already commercially exploiting the mineral resources of oil. That is what we call as a producing field. And three, exploration field. When I'm saying exploration field, we have not reached the development phase, C, D, and E. The gas production from fields A and B is transported onshore via pipeline in X. There is a pipeline X. It is intended that the same pipeline will be used for transporting the gas production from field C, D, and E if exploration is successful. In simple terms, there is a pipeline which I am using for A and B. The same pipeline can also be used for the other three fields which are under exploration stage as of now. In that particular situation, in March 2020, the management received a geological study showing that significant downward revisions in respect of two fields which are under exploration, C and D. E estimation remains unchanged. So now the problem is C and D has to be tested for impairment in case if I apply that principle. Production B, A and production B, production field B are not operationally dependent. That means they are generating independent cash flows. So if you really apply the principle, if you apply the principles of CGU, there is a possibility of we saying A is a separate CGU, B is a separate CGU, C is a separate field, D is a separate field, and E is a separate field, right? But here, out of that, C and D is one of the issue which we are seeing, and they are using the same pipeline in case commercially successful. Management expects that field C and production field A will be operationally dependent. That means production field C and A, what is existing, will be dependent if commercial viability has been established for C. So that means C cannot independently operate, it has to be dependent on A. So in that case, A and C will form together as a one CGU at a later point of time in case commercial viability has been made. Management expects that field D and E and production field B will be operational dependent. D, E and B will be dependent. So A and C will be dependent, D, E and B will be dependent if commercial viability is assessed for field D and in field E. So all the fields A, B, C, D, E are within the same segment of Ind AS 108 purposes. As we have seen, there is a significant downward revision on C and D based on the facts and circumstances. And accordingly, we have to determine what is the impairment test, how the CGU has to be determined for the purposes of making an impairment assessment as at 31st March 2020. So now what we have understood, A is producing field, B is a producing field. There are three exploration units, C, D and E. C and D seems to be having a downward revision. So we have to go for indication of impairment. The facts and circumstances indicate that you have to go for impairment assessment. Only additional information which we have is, in case C has been developed, it is dependent on A. Whereas if D and D are developed, they will be dependent on B. So that is what we have seen. E, as far as the production, the exploration unit E is concerned, there is no downward revision. Only two has a downward revision. So normally what we do, we will say that your D and E are separate exploration unit or exploration field, and to that extent they are CGUs. So they have to independently checked. That's what we will do. But this standard gives, that's what I'm actually giving. There is an impairment assessment. There is some guidance which is available that may be advantageous for the entity without charging the entire expenditure in the P&L account. It can still carry out that as part of the other fields. How it is possible? So for example, this is a pipeline which we are talking about and these are the field. Assuming that this is the pipeline and we have A, B, C, D and E. A and B are producing pipeline. So producing field. D, E and C are going to be, they are in the evaluation process. They are not yet reached the development stage. What we say is, in case if it is successful, C will be dependent on A, whereas D and E will be dependent on B. That's what we have said. So whether I have to consider C as a separate CGU, D and E as a separate CGU for the purposes of assessment, we understand that E has not have any impact, right? Only C and D has been having a downward revision. Whether I have to test and adjust this as an impairment separately, C as a separate one, or I can club that as part of A and C, B, D and E can be clubbed together. That is what we are saying. Ind AS 106 allows management flexibility in selecting its accounting policy for grouping of the exploration assets with producing asset. So A is a producing asset, B is a producing asset. The exploration assets can be grouped in such a manner with the flexibility based on the management purposes for impairment testing. So accordingly, when I'm testing the field C for impairment, I can group it as part of A and then test it. Similarly, in respect of D and E, as part of my D will be an impairment testing which we have to do, right? D can be added to field E and C as an another group, because C is totally a different scenario where there is no impairment test. So the D can be taken as part of B, C can be taken as part of A. Interestingly, what is not successful is added to a producing field. That flexibility has been given because ultimately the total expenditure will be amortized based on the production. So if you are able to demonstrate that there is an interdependency of this field when commercially viable, then you can group it. That's a thing which we have seen. C is dependent even when it's commercially successful based on A. And similarly, D and E has been said to be part of B. That's the way in which an exploration asset can be grouped as part of a producing asset for the purposes of impairment testing. Alternatively, management can also choose C as a separate unit, D as a separate unit, with field A, B, C on the basis of their largest grouping available within the same segment. That means you can consider C and D also as part of the entire segment because all of them are part of one segment. That is also possible, but smallest possible group is the best choice, right? So the first one will be the better choice, but you have the flexibility to do it. Whichever level of grouping management chooses, it must apply the policy from time to time. If you have decided that I will do it on the smallest possible combination, but not the entire segment, then you have to follow that principle. If you have applied segment as a general principle, then you have to apply that as a consistent basis year on year. That is what is the impairment testing. Now, on the disclosure part, it says that paragraph 23 is talking about the disclosures required. What is the accounting policy for exploration and evaluation expenditure, including how it will be recognized as an asset or expenditure? You have to disclose that. The amount of assets, liabilities, income, expenditure should be to be shown with respect to exploration and evaluation mineral resources as part of your balance sheet and the P&L. And related operating and investing policies should be shown as part of your statement of cash flows. So anything relating to producing field will be separate. Evaluation and exploration should be separately shown in the balance sheet, in the P&L, in the cash flow statement of cash flow statement. The exploration and evaluation asset should be shown as a separate class of asset, and it has to be shown as a separate item. If you see oil and gas companies, they will have exploration and evaluation asset as a separate line item on the face of the P&L balance sheet. What is the composition of that, tangible to intangible? That disclosure may be part on the face of the balance sheet or on the part of the note. You have to necessarily give that disclosure as well. So that is the end of our presentation with respect to Ind AS 106, exploration and evaluation of mineral resources. And we have seen the core principles which has to be applied to recognize the EEA items, and what is the items of expenditure which is not qualified part of exploration and evaluation asset, and what is the classification you have to do, tangible or intangible, depending upon the nature of that. And we have seen the impairment test, how it has to be done. What is the flexibility for impairment test of allocating the E&E assets into a development field or maybe to the segment and do an impairment test? The impairment test should be done based on the facts and circumstances, and which indirectly is nothing but the indicators of impairment. And what is the way in which your accounting policy should be selected? You have to mandatorily apply paragraph 10 of Ind AS 8, whereas 11 and 12 are given to you as an option. And finally, what is the disclosure which is required to be done? Very extensive coverage I have done for a small standard for you to understand. And in fact, I have given a lot of insights into the particular industry itself. You can actually apply these principles. With that, we will close this particular session. Any questions, any queries, any inputs, any improvements which you believe that we can do, you can post in our YouTube channel. I will answer that in the channel itself, and the entire subscriber base will also be very easily get the benefit of the notification immediately. And I should also thank all of you for spreading the message of the usefulness of this particular India's Knowledge Series video effort, which we have started nearly 1.5 months back. And we are almost going to complete with another maybe 5-6 standards which we have to cover. With that, we will be completing the entire process. To make this possible and making this successful, your encouraging words and motivating messages has helped me. And you have also spread that. I wanted to share with you that we have crossed the subscription subscribers limit of more than 1,000 subscribers. And I think as of now, we are somewhere around 1,200. And that is possible only because of your continuous support and spreading the message. And continue to do that. My endeavor of taking this effort, taking my time, keeping my official commitment on the back seat without any commercial exploitation. I'm thinking about doing this as a service to professionals as well as the students. Let this reach the complete audience, the maximum possible audience. That can be possible only if you spread the message and ask them to be part of our venture. So with that, thank you for watching this. We will come back with another standard on operating segments very quickly. There is Ind AS 107, which has to follow on Ind AS 106. And as I have told you earlier, 107 is talking about disclosure requirement relating to financial instrument. So naturally, it will be covered after 109. That's the reason why I'm saying the next video which I will upload will be on Ind AS 108 operating segment. Till such time, goodbye. Be safe with your family and be in your respective houses unless it is very, very necessary to move out of your houses. Be safe. Goodbye.